We are rolling. So tonight, we've got several pieces of business to cover before we actually get started, except Jen's going to open us with a brief treatment. Yep. And then we'll do a brief meditation as well, both brief. And so start by breathing now, because I don't want to take your breath away from you later as I do this. So turn it over to Jen.
All is spirit. Spirit is all. This divine creative energy and vibration. Limitless, everywhere, beauty beyond description, wholeness, health, joy, wonderment, everywhere. And as spirit is everything, everyone, everywhere, I know that I am all of this, as is everyone here present. We expand, we grow. We are wonderment and joy and beauty. And I know that we come here tonight to share our love of these wonderful teachings, to expand, to grow, to learn. And I give great thanks for this spiritual family of seekers, and for CSL Asheville, and this amazing opportunity to come together to learn and expand, to laugh, and to share our curiosity. And I release this into law, knowing that all these things are here, all is well, all is wonderful, and we open ourselves up to receive it. And in great gratitude, we say,
and so it is.
So in this circle of energy, just release your breath. And breathe in the divine, knowing that all life is connected. Every breath belongs to each of us. And in that knowing, as we release, and accept life, and we release, and as we know that our bodies are filled with the divine light, we think, and as we act, every step we take, everything we touch, every word we say, we know is filled with divine power. And where do we go with that? Where is that taking you right now, this evening? Knowing the power that resides within you. And as you breathe for the next couple of minutes, set your intention, set your progress, set your goal. Let your mind wander. As you're wandering, this vast amount of knowledge and awareness that you have, just say hello to the new ideas that come to you, to the new places. to the new goals. As you breathe with the heart of the I am, we receive and release and step forward on our path. Breathe in and focus on your breath. Every breath to a new awareness. Until it brings you back to this room, grounded and ready to move on. Did anyone else hear music?
Say it again.
Did anyone else hear music?
Mm-hmm. I heard motorcycles.
I heard like a radio or something in the
okay.
distance.
I was like, oh my God, I'm going to start channeling. The energy is there. That's one of my not goals, is to go into a meditation and not do that. It would scare me. I haven't gotten to that point yet. So Hopkins, so we're in the second half of Emma Curtis. Did anyone have any questions from the first round?
Were you wanting to finish doing the housekeeping thing about the number of classes?
You are my track girl. I love you. Yes. So just, we were talking right before class started that we're going to take the 17th off. I just want everyone to be on the same page, because I get confused. And so we'll meet next week, which is the 10th. But then we're going to take the 17th off, just have a break in there. So we'll start Troward next week. But we won't finish Troward until we come back on the 24th. And then we're going to do go through the 7th. Was that right? Or was it the 1st? Does anyone remember what we had said?
You said the 24th.
Well, we come back on the 24th.
Well, the next week
will
be on
the 1st.
Oh,
the next weekend would be the 31st.
31st.
So then we'll, but that's Memorial Day weekend. Oh, people will be back. So the 31st will be the last night.
Okay.
Last class?
31st.
31st.
Right, we're going to take a week break in between Troward, and then we'll come back, finish Troward, and just wind it all up.
Gotcha.
All right. Everyone good with that? Okay. So, back to Hopkins. So, everything in Hopkins, in the second half of Hopkins, the first six lessons are who are you? And they're based on these questions. What is your truth? What is your negation? What is your affirmation? What is your faith? And then she kind of starts moving into it. How do you express your faith? And all of those are key. And so last week, I had you walk through those. And I would actually like you to take time and do that again. What is your good today, right now, this moment? What is your good? What is the negation that follows that? Because frequently, that just follows us along. I want to lose weight. I can't because I don't have any willpower, right? I need to get more sleep, but I can't turn off Netflix. I want more money, but. I want to do this, but. And so what is your truth? What is the truth that you're seeking? What is your good? What is the negation that follows it? And then write your affirmation as well. And then we'll talk about the other two steps. But take a few minutes and do that. Because every day it's different. We don't only have one good in our life. That wouldn't be in the workbook. No.
I have paper.
I'll take it. Abundance is flowing. What is your good? I have paper.
Thank you.
Affirmation. Who would like to start? We're going to do the call and response thing. We're going to affirm everyone as they speak. We can go, yes, you are. Yes, it is. Wave our little jazz hands. Clap. But practice affirming each other because that is the healing process that Emma tells us to do in the second half of the book, is that all we do is affirm one another, know the truth of each other. And so let's practice that with our affirmations now. Who would like to go first? Sure.
I am healthy.
Oh, let's stand up. Sorry.
Everybody calling us.
I didn't know if you meant one at a time.
Yeah, no.
I am healthy and fit.
Yes, you are. Yes.
Since God is perfect order, then I have perfect order in my life.
Yes, you do.
I am freedom.
Yes, you are.
I am presence.
Yes, you are.
Yes.
I experience the divine in and through all things.
Yes, you do.
Yes.
I am open to joyful, healthy relationships.
Yes, you are.
Yes.
I am filled with vitality and boundless energy.
Yes, you are.
I am truth.
Yes, you are.
I am freedom.
Yes, you are.
I am whole and complete.
Yes, you are.
And so are you. Yeah. All right. So then following this, what is your faith that this is true? How would you define that? What is your faith that this is true? After reading all of this about Emma Curtis Hopkins and everything she has to say, what is your faith? And then you can, if it's easier, how do you express it? Or how do you demonstrate it? Or how do you share it? How do you live your faith? Those are all different ways of saying the same thing, and yet each word, which we know, because our communication and the way we communicate and the words that we choose are so precious. And each one of these words means something different. And so as you look at those, you do each one of those things differently. So what is your faith? How do you know that affirmation is true first? What is your faith?
Dakota, ahead.
Yeah, go ahead, just speak.
You know, I just underlined that in Ernest Holmes' papers.
Mm-hmm.
And it is thought applied consciously with acceptance.
Okay.
So it's conscious thought coming from a place of acceptance.
That's excellent, yeah. Thank you, Ernest, and thank you, Dakota.
Yeah, right.
Okay. Anyone else?
I just got, it's a knowing.
A knowing, yeah?
It's, for me, it's step one. It's recognition.
Okay.
Of the one.
Recognition?
Yeah.
Yeah? When you said step one, my mind, because I'm so indoctrinated.
That's
you
okay.
Know, my first thought went to AA, you know?
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
Step
yeah.
one, that's true. That's true.
Yeah.
I am powerless? No, that's wrong.
I think it's a combination of step one and step two for me. Because I unless I recognize myself as the divine, then I won't always see myself as free.
Okay.
Yeah.
Anyone else? What is your faith? How would you define it?
I'm still processing this one, but I define my faith as my appreciation, awe, and zeal for life and that which I experience.
I like that word, zeal. I think that's good. Appreciation, awe, and zeal of your life experience. That's good.
I thought that's the question we just answered.
Hmm?
I thought that's the question we just all answered.
I don't understand what you're saying.
What is your faith? I thought that was the question we just
all
answered.
We are answering that. That's what Michael just answered.
Well, I know, but it sounded like you were saying it as a separate question. And so
I was just repeating it with an inflection at the end to acknowledge what Michael had said. Yes.
I want to read from the book, When Our Faith is Strong.
What page?
Oh, 69.
69? Okay.
The end of the second paragraph. When our faith is strong, we don't have to deal with any situations in the environment. They take care of themselves. And let us focus on principles. Works are the activity of faith, not effort. I just resonated with that. It's the same as Ernest saying, turn away from the condition and recognize the principle, which is the opposite of the condition you're whining about.
Right.
And so when I have faith, I can do that with ease, and I'm not stuck in the moment, in the traffic, in the relationship, in what is happening in that moment, but I have faith that everything is evolving as it does, and I don't have to work so hard.
Right, right. How many people were at Sunday service and heard John? Right? Yeah, so were you? No? Yeah, you were here.
Mm-hmm.
And it's that moment of knowing that the statement is the truth,
mm-hmm.
and not work in itself. That's what you're saying. And I thought, oh, how apropos that he was paraphrasing Hopkins for us tonight. So there's that moment of when we recognize that that which we say, our word, is exactly what the truth is. Right?
Mm-hmm.
We don't wait for the manifestation. Once we say it,
it already is.
Right. So how do you express your faith, or how do you express your good? How do you express it?
Be it.
Pardon?
Be it.
You be it. How do you be it?
By consciously keeping my thoughts in check to the extent that I can, as the imperfect person that I am in the moment. But yeah, to just consciously just be aware of that voice in your head.
Okay.
And to constantly, continuously come back. And treatment has been phenomenal for me. So I do my treatments in the morning, usually one in the middle of the day, and spend a bit of time at night. And
mm-hmm.
it keeps you focused on the principles rather than the situation.
Okay, good. How do other people express your faith or your good?
I think I express mine through gratitude.
Okay.
Just seems very powerful. And sharing that, it seems like the more all of this I share with others, it's an amazing gift for them, but it always comes back in a very powerful way.
Mm-hmm. This is true.
express my faith through being in the flow of my life without what I did in the past was to attempt to control it. So whatever happens is what's happening. And I know it's perfect just as it's happening. So I don't lose it.
I was thinking something similar. For me, it was to live my life without judgment. I'm still trying to refine that one, but not very articulate. But that's the nutshell in it.
Yeah.
Anyone else an expression?
I guess in pondering this, that I express my faith moment by moment when I'm happy, when I'm being happy, and I'm present here and now. I'm not thinking of the past. I'm not thinking of the future. I'm not thinking. I'm just feeling happy. Is such a happy word, excuse the expression. It's overused. I feel a sense of okayness, a sense of just everything is okay, everything is right, everything is beautiful, everything is joyful. And when that's going on in my day, that's my faith.
Mm-hmm.
When I start with a monkey mind, I've gone somewhere else.
Okay.
When I was, as I'm hearing other people talking, I'm like, absolutely. and what it all wheeled around to is I express my faith when I'm cognizant of being the best me that I can be. And that is being in gratitude and being in the flow of things and not judging things.
Yeah.
And when I am being aware of wanting to be the best, my highest self, that for me is how I express my faith.
Okay. Any other comments on expression of faith? Okay, so then take a deep breath, let it go, and then take a moment and ponder, how do you demonstrate it, and how is that different? How do you demonstrate your faith as different from expression of your faith? Would like to start us off in demonstration. How do you demonstrate your faith?
By being kind, loving, generous, supportive, and joy-filled.
Okay.
So when I feel like when I'm again being the best me I can be, those are the characteristics that I try to bring to
Okay. Good.
I express my faith and demonstrate my faith through acts of courage.
I like that.
Acts of kindness.
Okay.
Sharing joy.
Yep.
Just being overflowing with joy.
I guess
I demonstrate my faith by wholeheartedly feeling friendly and accepting everyone without judgment.
Okay. Anyone else demonstrate your faith? How do you demonstrate your faith?
Vitality, love, joy, being the best me I can be in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What is the difference between expression and demonstration?
Pardon?
What is the difference between expression and demonstration?
I think that, you know, if we wanted to look in the thesaurus, we could get some real dictionary definitions.
Yes.
But I think it's going to be different when we're talking about this kind of subject for everyone.
Yeah.
And for me, how do I express my good or my faith? Is I think I express it through happiness. I do. How do I demonstrate that? Is different. You know, it's kind of like I want to share that happiness with others. I want to demonstrate that my life is good somehow.
So
but
then
sharing is something different. Sharing might, for me, go back to courage,
mm-hmm.
right? For me, to step in front of every class takes courage, because before every class,
absolutely.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how long in the semester, all the way up those stairs I'm going to. I know everything I say, it's going to be perfect. I know it's all unfolding perfectly. And because, you know, it's just that sharing, because, you know, all of us in our own way, we do things differently, and we give so much of ourselves, especially once we've come into Science of Mind. So I think it's different for everyone.
Okay.
So, yeah. So how do other people demonstrate or share your faith? How do you share your faith then? As different from expressing
your faith
it or
your
demonstrating
good.
It.
Your faith or your good?
Pardon?
Your faith or your good?
I don't know. Are they different?
Well, I'm just looking at the questions. The way.
Yeah, that's the question though. And you use them interchangeably. So, because if we're looking at like John's talk on Sunday, it's
mm-hmm.
the same thing.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Our good is our God. Our God is our faith is our life. You know, everything, it's all one. So there is no process to get to the other, right? And so I've been using them interchangeably, deliberately. Not to just mess with you. But so if you see it differently, how would you express your good then, or how would you share it?
Okay.
Is it different if you change the words? Because words are important.
Yeah. It is for me.
It's different, whether it's faith or good?
Or demonstrate. No, not faith or good.
Oh.
But the different, yeah, sorry. Not
okay,
yeah,
so demonstrating it is one thing, sharing
yeah.
it
sharing
is another.
Absolutely.
Okay, how do you share your good, or how do you share your faith?
By being in a place of love that empowers others as well as myself to be my true self so that they can be their true self.
Okay. That's good.
I'm thinking about listening. I'm thinking about my day today and the calls I got during the day and all the listening that I did this morning to people who were having some challenges with life. And simply by listening and giving, just really giving repeating back what I heard in that art form of listening,
mm-hmm.
so that people could hear themselves. I was sharing what I heard underneath the surface. And that took a lot of courage because it wasn't necessarily being said, and yet that's what I was hearing.
Mm-hmm. So you demonstrate or share your faith by listening?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Honesty.
Mm. That's what I was thinking. Honesty,
yeah, honesty
is how you share it?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's lovely.
That's, Rhonda, you said that's what you were
thinking. Yeah, I was thinking truth or honesty, because it seems like the more of these classes I come to, then people call you and whine and complain, and you're just kind of beyond that, but you still have to, you know, you have to be. So it's like you end up being truthful and honest with them. And that's bravery and courage to these people from your past, that you're being honest with them, mm-hmm. on how you feel about what they're saying to you. Or
so is that, are you demonstrating then your faith or your good, or are you sharing it at that point? Or is it the same?
Well, demonstrating, I was thinking more of accepting and not resisting.
Mm-hmm.
I kept getting confused because of demonstrating.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But that's how I feel right now in my life, that I'm being more accepting towards whether people or events, and not resisting and fighting things as much.
Okay.
So,
good.
The sharing, I was thinking truth and honesty.
How about you, Katie? How do you share your good or your good?
I'm kind of on the next question.
You're kind of on the next question. How do you live it?
How do I live it? In trust is what comes.
Mm.
You know. Just, I've had a life challenge since I've been in this class, and just trusting that it would all work out,
mm-hmm.
and that I had the skills to solve it, which were given to me by God, you know.
Okay. Breezy, is your hand up?
No, my
no.
hand
okay.
itches.
Mm-hmm.
I guess, so I'm thinking of it, sharing has changed for me dramatically into allowing, because I realize now, I have a neighbor, and this went on for about 2 or 3 years, and I thought I was sharing, and in the long run, when I looked at it, the relationship got worse and worse and worse, and I finally recognized that I wanted this person to agree with me, or to accept my ideas,
mm-hmm.
so we could be, in quotes, friends.
Right.
And I made a real mess of it. And it wasn't until, I'm going to say, the last couple of, two or three months, and I couldn't find the word why there was this change, and just by hearing all of you, I realized it's by allowing her to be who she is. Everything has been just changed totally. And, you know, whether we're best buddies or not, it doesn't matter. The healing is the allowing for me.
That's a great phrase.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The healing is the allowing. How do other people live their faith?
You mean other faiths?
Other faiths?
Yeah.
No, just how do you live your good? How do you live your faith? On a daily basis. Whatever that means to you. I don't have any set answer for it. It's not like, you know, you're going to get 5 points or anything.
Well, I don't think I live it on a daily basis. I try to live it on a daily basis.
The correct answer. See, I think that is the correct answer right there.
I think
to be the best that we can be at any given time on a daily basis.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I live my life by sharing it.
Okay. On a daily basis?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
Yeah. And the days I don't do that because of reasons that I'm not able to or whatever, don't feel right. They don't feel as meaningful, they don't feel as full.
You know, there's a word that keeps coming up for me, but I would like it to be a different word. Maybe it's allowing, but the word that keeps coming up for me is surrender, surrendering to the moment, because there's, on a daily basis, I still run into resistance, kind of accepting, loving of all of the core principles.
Mm-hmm.
There are these, you know, bits of resistance that will just show up in lots of different ways.
Is it resistance from you or from other people?
No, me.
So it goes to the negation piece.
Yeah, it does. Okay. And then it's like I have to just surrender to the principles.
Mm-hmm.
But I think maybe that's really allowing.
Mm-hmm.
That's probably a better word than surrender, which sounds so hopeless.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone else?
My negation shows up in relationships that are partner kinds of relationships.
You mean like life partner or business partner or
like,
any partner?
Yeah, any.
Okay.
Hmm.
When reaching consensus is very challenging, and I know I'm right for me.
So what's the negation?
It feels yucky. I mean that's the piece of it. It doesn't feel like I'm doing my best. It feels, and yet I underline that as I'm thinking about it now. It's when my fear comes up that someone else will make a decision that affects me in a negative way, and it's not what I would be choosing.
Mm-hmm. And so where do you go with that?
I'm alone.
Right. How else do people live their faith? I feel the fear and do it anyway. Often I'm charging full steam ahead, going la 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 la, and trying to keep that fear to, you know, from clouding everything in my head, keep it down, but it's still in the background. And I believe also that affects my judgment. And so because it's still there, I haven't negated it and released it. I've only allowed it to be in there kind of like a, you know, a misfiring spark plug. You know what I mean? And so, it, you know, I'm going and then I'm like, and then I go again like that. And it's like fate that so I think I try to sometimes, I believe I'm becoming more articulate, but an expression of my faith in my good. But I think that's at this point right now. This is how I'm living my faith, kind of like a misfiring spark. That's what it feels like. It doesn't feel like a bad thing. It feels like, you know, need to, you know, check the gap on that. Right. It's kind of like when you're on the tube in London and they're like, mind the gap, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know if anyone, has anyone been on the tube? Yeah. That's what their recorded voice says, is mind the gap, like that, in a very nice tone and nice accent. And the point is to watch your step when you get off the train.
Mind the gap.
That's what I feel like I'm doing.
I just love some of her writings, the way she expresses some of these things. And like on page 71, in the second paragraph, it starts with the world that we experience. I love it halfway down there when she's talking about anyone who loves their thoughts greatly and loves their words greatly is sure to be a musician of some kind. There is much joy in their lives too, as they continually experience the song of the spirit in their thoughts and words. That's just so beautifully written.
And did you say page 71?
Uh-huh.
So I had this when you claimed a page two.
In this
book? I have an old book, I guess.
In this book?
Yeah, it seems like that book, but I don't see that page.
Bottom paragraph is Words of Faith?
No.
Okay.
On page 71 for me is the beginning of lesson 5.
The
Words of Faith.
I think we had that problem with the...
With the class.
With the class.
Yes,
you have a different edition.
Book. Yeah.
This is what happens when you buy from Amazon instead of the center, I guess.
Well, I bought this from Amazon.
How about this from Amazon?
Incidentally, I have
the gap.
Mine is a first printing from 2005.
And this is a second.
It's also a bigger book than this one, it seems.
Physically.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, this is...
It could be just because it's so doggy.
Oh, well, the second printing is 2008.
Yeah.
Maybe
and
one.
So, if it's under Words of Faith, I have that, but for me it's on page 73.
No, it's above that. It's
right.
two paragraphs
above
that.
It.
Then it's still on page 73.
So maybe you're just like two pages
off. Anyway, I just love that paragraph because she's talking about, and you've talked about this, Kate, so much, the power of words.
Mm-hmm.
And our thoughts are made up of words. So,
well, sometimes.
And she's talking about the person who loves their words greatly is sure to experience the song of the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
That's beautiful.
It's very poetic.
Yeah.
It is. And that's where, you know, we express our truth with words and actions and deeds and all of that. And so, but then we follow that up with negation and that hinders. It's like that misfire and spark plug. So then if we bring that around and come back to what the affirmation is and negate that, then that's where the power is. The power is in the affirmation. But a lot of people are told what their truth is, which is what we do here. We tell you what your truth is, and without allowing people to experience the negation of it. And so we overlook that piece, and people are like, I don't want to deal in the negative. I don't want to look at the bad stuff. But if you don't look at the bad stuff, you can't really affirm it to the truth. We have to recognize what's holding us back before we can move forward. We can always blindly continue to move forward, but somewhere it's going to hook us again. And that's where the affirmation is. And that's why she spends so much energy on you in the first 6 lessons. So that when you go to practice and you are healers, this is what you're doing. How do you live and how do you share and how do you demonstrate? You are the healers of the word right now. You are already here. It's not a process. Or you wouldn't be in this class. Right? As soon as you said Emma Curtis Hopkins, there, you became it. Even with whatever negation was in your background. Even if you say, oh, I don't know enough about Emma yet, that's a negation. Because what we know is what? That it's all one mind. And so the truth is already flowing through you. you are that which you believe. And if you believe this or if you believe this, that's the only question. And so that's why she goes into the fourth part section of that, what is your faith? Because if you move into healing, right, which is where we are, and each one of the next six pair with the previous six. So if we're looking at faith, then we're looking at how do we live it, how do we move among people and express our faith that encourages them to heal in whatever way. And that's where we'll take a break, because when we come back, we'll start right there. It's like, how do you move in the world as a healer? Because that's what Emma is telling us.
And so it is.
I'm going to say something else just to keep you doing this. Okay.
Stop. Yes,
yes.
No?
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So the question was, right before we were leaving for break, was, well, there was the statement first, that you are already the healer, right? You already are, because that's the whole purpose of Emma Curtis Hopkins, isn't to heal people, it's to encourage people to become
yes.
the healer.
Mm-hmm.
And that's her whole lesson, that's what all 12 lessons are. Again, the first six focus on you, and the second six focus on how you take it out into the world, and how you live your life. So, how do you do that? So, we talked about it as faith, but is it different knowing the truth of who you are? Does that change it?
Knowing the truth of who we are, does that change what?
How you express your faith.
Yeah. I mean, until I got into these teachings, yeah.
Right.
Big, big change.
Can you see also where Emma Curtis Hopkins informed Ernest Holmes?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. That's the other key thing of just having 2 weeks of Emma in a group class.
So she would be the teacher of teachers.
She is the teacher.
Yes, because from this point of view, because of the healing.
Yes. Yeah, it crossed the board in all new thought.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So what is it that needs to be healed, is the question. Is it the person's faith or the affliction that they're presenting?
Their negation.
It's
yeah.
their negation, exactly that. So how do you do that? I think my mind just went down.
You really need Michelle. To know
Michelle. Michelle. I think Michelle said it in terms of listening. I think sometimes affirmation only, or the negation only needs to be listened to, and someone can hear themselves say it and
mm-hmm.
go,
mm-hmm.
I want to change that.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
The second thought.
Right. So, go ahead.
Well, are you speaking about somebody who is coming for healing, or are you speaking for the people at large that we come in contact with on a daily basis? Because if somebody's coming for healing, that means they're in a place to want, they're in a place where they're trying to receive something, and by listening to them, then they can hear themselves.
Okay.
But I have found out in the world that a lot of people like hearing themselves and really want to just ratchet it up even more and take a lot of comfort in finding people who tell them how horrible it is.
Mm-hmm.
And,
yeah, they
and
want they want affirmation about how horrible things are.
Right, so then that takes us back to the question of how do you share or live or demonstrate your own faith?
Which, and I didn't answer that question because I you moved on to live and I was still on share.
Oh, okay.
it was fine. But I was thinking that I try to share my faith by stealing the center's things, by being a not only a beacon, by being authentic, but also being a, I'll say, appropriate mirror for other people. So when they're seeing things being really, really crappy, I try to see them and see their situation through the eyes that I'd like to be, you know, expressing on my best days.
Right.
And that just happened actually 3 times today within my interaction with young people.
Mm-hmm.
And it just, as long as, if you have a relationship with somebody, as long as you are being authentic to yourself, then I believe that people respond to that well. Not always positively at first, but well. But all of this is kind of negated by the fact that what I got out of a lot of the second half is, if I am healing myself, if I am in a place of perfect health, acceptance, and godness, then the only thing that I'm going to experience on the outside of me is that godness.
Mm-hmm.
So I will not, there won't be sickness, there won't be anything around that needs to be healed, because I will have taken things, I will have taken care of that within myself, and that's the only thing that I'm going to experience. One of the quotes were, I'm completely butchering it, is, but when you get good enough, then the people will be healed before they even come to you.
Absolutely.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So that was my general point.
to your general point in terms of negation to something that we were saying.
To how to be healers in
right.
the world.
Right. Good. Thank you. So then it's really, if we still see it or hear it, then it's really us that needs to be healed.
Mm-hmm. Heal thyself.
Right?
Mm-hmm. It's hard to swallow, but that's what I believe.
Right. Because I have a student that it doesn't matter, I can say, wow, that was just amazingly creative. And she'll go, wow. And I'm like, the other day I just said, you know, you really need to change your story, because you're going to keep repeating this life. If you want it, then keep talking about it. But not in my class anymore.
Yeah.
You know, and it was like, okay, so now Science of Mind is coming into my classroom. So how do, you know, but so the point is of that little story is, there's something I still need to heal. Like, I can still see that, or I still hear it.
Well, and that's one of the challenges, I think, for me, is because you do still hear it and see it, and, you know, your body you react to it, because we're not in that total God place, and kind of when I'm by myself, I can get into that space. I can get into that space, and I can be in that space and stay there for an hour or 2 hours.
You mean that cycle of, like...
The God space.
Oh, okay. Oh, in the God space.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I can, like, do that, but it's only me. But,
yeah.
Right? But when it's the world, when I'm engaging the world, and then there's the reflections, I find it challenging to appropriately... kind of generate the responses that don't just sometimes come from from the God space, or, you know, sometimes my response may be exactly what they need to grow, but that's a challenge for me, and I don't know about anybody else, but I mean, kind of, do you react at all? Is it appropriate? I mean, and I guess for everybody it's different, but any input on that as far as living?
Well, Emma would say go to the negation.
And
to the affirmation that there is no disharmony. There
right.
is only harmony in the world. And to go to that point and to get there as quickly as possible by recognizing your own.
The negation, and then just literally from there going into the affirmation.
Right. So as a healer, that's what she would say. That's kind of how she's led us into this second half of the book in a large, general, very quick way.
So
yeah.
With your student, where does that go with that? Is it just for you, or is that something that you then lay out for her? Do you lay out an affirmation for her to be something different?
Oh, absolutely. I tell her affirmations all the time.
Right.
I say, no, I don't even hear it anymore. You are amazing.
Right.
You are incredibly creative. You're really, really perceptive.
Right.
You have an ability to articulate your beliefs that are astound me.
Right.
And, you know, I say different things for the last 16 weeks.
Oh my God.
And I have faith. Something is rooted hold in there. Because
yeah.
she follows me around down the hallway now.
Awesome. Okay.
Yeah, she needs that.
Yeah.
She needs that.
So I have a different perspective on this, and maybe I could get some clarity. But before I was in Science of Mind, I was I tried to recruit people into my faith actively, and it was almost like notches in the bedpost, you know?
Mm-hmm.
How many people did I save today, you know? And it's
right.
just kind of like, I kind of want to leave people where they are, you know? And I don't know if that's a deficiency in my faith or a growth that I need to make in my faith. But, you know, if somebody kind of wants to mire in the muck, you know, I don't necessarily throw pearls among swine, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I had that same reaction as you did, because one of the things I dislike about, especially born-again Christianity, is a lot of some people have the tendency to put it in your face,
mm-hmm.
whether you even ask for it or not. And I've always found that offensive. But when I was reading some of Hopkins, it was like some of it kind of reminded me of that you need to go and heal these people without them coming to you.
Right.
And I'm like, well, wait a minute. That's just as presumptuous as what Christianity is saying.
See, and I don't see that she's saying that.
Mm-hmm.
I don't see any paradox or negation in that at all. I see that what she's saying is that when we know ourselves to be the healer, when we know ourselves to be the divine, our presence in itself is healing to others.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So I had a thing last weekend. So I had to rush out of town to go be with my family because my little sister's house was broken into and she was raped.
Oh.
And the man was caught that night.
Mm.
So, like, there's all those emotions there, but, like, when I got to my little sister, I was peaceful.
Mm-hmm.
It was weird. Didn't even talk about it. Just spent time with her, then went on to my parents' house, spent time with my parents and my older sister. Then the next morning went to court, saw him, saw his family, and it was more like I just felt sorry for them.
Mm-hmm.
Not angry, just sorry.
Mm-hmm.
And then it was like peaceful after that. And she's back in her house, her kids moving in with her, and her husband, and their dog, and their child. She's back to work, and I mean, it was just, it's not preaching,
mm-hmm.
it's just
oh yeah,
being present, but not finding anything wrong. The non-resistance. It's like, this happened.
Right.
This is horrible that it happened.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like, it's gonna be okay.
Yeah. So that's how
and she's okay, you know?
Right.
Well, it's kind of like, at least it comes across to me, it's kind of like passive as opposed to aggressive. And so, like, it's like a passive healing as opposed to an aggressive healing type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's they absorb the healing energy because passively, you're not pushing it on them, you're just radiating it. And so they absorb it passively as opposed to aggressively. And
right.
It doesn't come across to them as... You know.
See, I think we can be assertive in our faith without being evangelical.
Mm-hmm.
That we can, like, reflect back to people, like Michael was saying, that we can reflect back to people, or what you were saying as well when you were talking about listening, Michelle, that what we see as the truth, what we believe is the truth, and people can take it or not, but we don't have to say, you know, science of mind, come, Ernest Holmes, like that, you know, come to the center at 11, like that, you know.
I guess it's just to have still such an aversion to being past evangelistic,
mm-hmm.
that I don't necessarily feel it's my place to be somebody else's mayor, so...
That's
and I realized that's why I was having such a hard time coming up with how do you demonstrate your good and share your good, or faith.
But how can you not be someone's mirror?
Yeah.
But you don't say you're someone's mirror. They have to recognize it.
Yeah, but so but that's not what Katie was saying.
Can you repeat the question?
How can you not be someone's mirror? If everyone
that's
is
up
a mirror,
to the person to be able to see it.
Right.
But
to define the reflection for them is something else.
I guess that was a better choice of words than.
But you're going to be their mirror, no matter what.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever they see in that reflection. Because they're reflecting back to you, which is what Michael was saying, that that's where we still need to be healed ourselves.
Right.
That's our own process of coming to faith.
Right.
Right.
But it's like you don't even ever have to say anything.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You can just know.
Mm-hmm.
And that comes out of you. It's like you feel it.
Mm-hmm.
Like I know that some people here, sometimes they're clear, and they can just look you in the eye, and you just feel it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's like,
mm-hmm.
it's crazy. Crazy cool.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, even though I went there, I just never said anything.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, I didn't talk most of the time, but I was just peaceful most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
And I just looked at everybody with love, and that's all I felt. It was, it usually I would be like, like 2 years ago, I probably would have like, freaked out.
Right.
So,
and then back to what you're saying is kind of an extension of what Breezy was saying, but in Hopkins, on my thing under shaping the world, in lesson 10, it's the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I don't know. It's after shaping the world. It's the third paragraph after shaping the world. She says, gentleness, love, cheerfulness. These may be, seem slow to conquer the world, but they have deity in all its force behind them.
Hmm.
And so in some ways, someone might see that as very passive. I see that as very assertive. I see that as
mm-hmm.
as a, you know, a way to live life in a happy, positive, gentle, cheerful way.
Mm-hmm.
I see it as a great force that we have.
You and that's kind of what I did this week. It, you know, my landlord gave me 30 days to get out, and I got out, of course, and I gave him my keys on Monday, and I shook his hand and said, you know, I wish you the best of luck. And, you know, people were like, who aren't in Science of Mind, were like, how in the world could you say that? He turned your life upside down, and I'm like, but he has no power to turn my life upside
that's
down.
That's right.
So, and also I wanted to keep my side of the street clean.
Mm-hmm.
To me, that was, I still see that as being passive, as Breezy was saying, but I kind of like how you're saying it's more assertive.
Yeah.
It's powerful.
It is truly powerful.
Yeah.
That's the power.
But just because something is passive does not mean it's not powerful.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's true.
And passivity can be extremely powerful.
Well, I don't, but I don't see it as passive at all.
Yeah.
No. I see it as active, as
yeah.
as living your faith.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah, that active. That comes up somewhere else. Where is that? It will come to me. It's in one of these classes. We talked about it. That kind of active faith thing.
Wasn't it in Emerson?
Oh, was it in Emerson? Oh, that's disappointing to me. But that's obviously, I still need to heal around everything. So let's, before the last, you know, half hour, let's look at the five chapters of this book. And was there something that stood out to you about science of mind and its relation to science of mind, or, you know, the, what we've been talking about? Because this book is just full of stuff. And because under our perfect gift, and I don't even... For me, it's on page 137. Again, it's in lesson 10. She says that each of us has a particular achievement to accomplish. And whatever that accomplishment is, whatever that thing is like, what do you believe is your divine purpose? And John has his whole program that he does around finding your divine purpose. And I don't want to go into that. But in your own meditation, in your own spiritual practice, what has come up for you as your divine purpose? What is your achievement in that sense, a particular achievement to accomplish?
I assist others in enhancing their daily experience of the divine.
Okay. It just has such a ring to it. I love that. And I guess that leads me to a different question. Who's got a daily spiritual practice? B, you do, right? Perhaps. A frequent spiritual practice, maybe. Maybe not daily?
No, I have daily, but...
Okay. So, because Emma Curtis Hopkins is also very clear that you need to have a daily spiritual practice
mm-hmm.
of reading, writing, and
okay.
meditating. Yes.
Speaking.
Pardon?
She does a big thing about speaking.
In expression.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. So, at the height of your unique genius rests some masterpiece of splendor laid out for you to do from beginning before ever the world was. Before the world came into being, our genius was out there waiting to become genius.
Mm.
Pretty cool, huh? Before you even conceived, you were conceived into brightness and being. I just feel like such a preacher when I'm talking about Hopkins. anything else? Because I could go on, because I just love this whole book.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I have a question. On page, on the workbook.
Oh, no. In the workbook.
No, it's not any of the questions.
Okay.
Believe me. I didn't even look at those. Page 102. It says, Emma Curtis Hopkins, the teacher of teachers.
Mm-hmm.
So it says, in 1885, she was relieved of her post under Mary Baker Eddy.
Yep.
And evicted from her church-owned home.
Mm-hmm.
Reasons for this have depended on the perspective of whoever was offering them. Some have said she was deluded or corrupting the Christian Science teaching.
Others said that she had developed a close friendship with another student, which Eddie found conspiratorial and threatening.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know any more specifics on that?
No, it's just the rumor is that she had close companionships with women, and that so did Eddie, and that there was
some jealousy
happening.
Okay. That's what
but
I was
that the difference between their faiths are that Hopkins believed that God existed, that the divine was in everything and everyone,
mm-hmm.
and if you believe that that pill's going to heal you, then that pill will heal you.
Yeah.
And if you don't believe that, you know, smoking will give you lung cancer, then it won't. If you just see it as a divine breath of life, then then so it is. And it's the level of awareness, and they differed on their level of awareness,
mm-hmm.
in terms of what the truth was. And so that's really why she was probably, you know, perhaps jealousy is at the root of it, but...
Did Mary Baker Eddy think that she was the only conduit of God, though?
Mm-hmm.
That nobody else.
But so does Hopkins.
Mm-hmm.
Think that we are definitely spirit. We are the divine.
No, that Mary Baker Eddy thought she was the only person
that had the
connection.
Yeah.
To spirit or God or whatever she wanted to call it.
I have really good friends who are Christian Science, and so. They seem to do fine in their life. They're healthy, well. So I don't really see what the big difference is in our feds, really. But I understand the difference, but not in how we live our lives.
Mm. But I mean, that's really important, because as I've been reading Emma, is that if you are totally one-pointed in your faith that you have something.
Mm-hmm.
You can be the nastiest person in the world, you can be the nicest person in the world, you're gonna get what you believe you can get.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so therefore, it becomes, for me, it's making a leap that makes that okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That I'm not struggling with it, but I'm seeing it, and it's interesting because, of course, I've been applying it, guess who? It's like very slowly the antagonism, my frustration, and my wanting to strangle certain people is getting less. It's just beginning to melt.
Good.
And I'm no longer reacting. And that's that word that came to me when you were talking about allowing. I'm allowing. Am I allowing this person to be who they are, and that's their good in their eyes?
Okay.
It is just taking a huge burden off of me.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
But how do you put... Then I go back to, okay, what's good and what's bad.
Right.
And then I get caught in the negation,
mm-hmm.
which you were talking about, which I hadn't seen before. And now I'm seeing as you pushed me today to think... It's really mind-boggling.
So if we can allow people to be who they are and to gaze at them without judgment and just be the reflection of the divine, whatever their level of perception is, that in itself is healing,
mm-hmm.
right? Because
they are the
boy,
divine.
When someone looks
yeah.
at me with love and just pure acceptance, it touches my heart, and
mm-hmm.
I'm a better person, or I've
yeah.
changed somewhere, and it makes it more difficult to go back to the you know, monkeys that want to keep spinning the wheel.
Mm-hmm.
Although they too are, you know, creatures of the divine. So they spin well.
That poor monkey.
That monkey chose its path.
Uh-huh.
gets deep. That's how I learn the best. So, any other, you know, any chapter, we're not going in any order. So if there's something that stands out to you, one of her quotes or something to read that you may have underlined or something.
I like her concept of covenant.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoyed it because it taught me a big lesson of I had been living my life on contract versus covenant.
Right.
And so now covenant has an amazing new meaning for me, and it's a covenant of good. So agreeing with good, agreeing with faith, agreeing with spirit, and it's not that easy. When, and here is where you're saying, Dakota, many times you all notice, you might notice that I'm sitting here with my eyes closed, and it because it helps me. My physical senses will tend to sometimes draw me into matter and the physical, in quotes, reality. If I close my eyes, and that's another thing she said in one of the chapters, the senses are spiritual. You're
right.
Hearing, you're seeing, and it's just...
Right. She says, yeah. Relax your body.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Drop sights and sounds. Drop
mm-hmm.
emotions. Cease your thoughts and become blank for a few moments.
Mm-hmm.
This is a way of letting go, of rejecting old thoughts. Allow one positive thought to fill your mind. Hold the thought firmly. It will in time demonstrate in outward conditions. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's something I've always admired about you, that you've been able to, in all of these evenings that we've spent together, that you've been able to just stop and go.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to be, you know, quiet and let you do your thing, but I want to keep going, you know, because I know that you know exactly where you are. And so,
well,
thank you very much.
You have faith in me. Thank you.
I love lesson 7, when she goes into the actual practice, because... she was saying with a client, things to remind them of, and there's all those things listed. I just think that those are wonderful things for us to just re-remind ourselves of.
Right.
Before we do treatment either on ourselves or someone else. But just lovely.
What page is that on?
Well, it's 105 in my book.
Yeah.
It's called Lesson 7, The Practice.
It's called what?
The Practice.
I am in class.
And what are the things that she...
So I should shut
it's
when I get home, I'll call you.
With a client, and she lists probably 15 or 20 paragraphs. Like, for example, the first one is, you are spirit, therefore you are not afflicted with any kind of disease or distress. I see you in spirit as the health that you are. The spirit knows nothing of imperfection. And then it's all...
Right, those things do.
Yeah, they're lovely.
Anything stand out to you, Brucey? In all of this?
Not that I remember right offhand. I don't have the book with me.
Do you like Emma?
Yeah.
What stands out about Hopkins herself to you and what we learned?
Herself?
Yeah, like or her teaching.
Well, I like that she... her knowing and her intuition.
Yeah. And that trusting that in ourselves. Yeah. You have really strong intuition, don't you? Yeah. You're a strong woman.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, Dakota, have you been away? You were away for a while?
Yeah, and moving and been traveling and just kind of...
And are you back now?
I am. And I've moved and...
Okay. Well, I'm really glad that you came.
Yeah.
You finished out the second half of this class. Are you gonna? You think?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I do.
Anything standing out for you, ma'am? Nothing in particular out of these six.
Well,
chapters?
I mean.
I'm preferential to the first six myself. I am. And I don't know why that is. And I know other people who like, oh, it's not the first six, it's the second six, because they like to really get out there and, you know, do things. And I'm all about this whole self-reflection and growth. And I think that there are times when I really just need to, you know, tell my mind to stop it and just move forward, you know, just goal, because
do something.
Yeah, you know, I can, you know, get like you're saying, when I'm alone I can be all holy and see the aura and the plants,
right.
And
well, and it's like,
right.
It's
and
like
as soon as I have a guest coming over, I look out the window and think, oh wow, I should really have washed the pain, you know, instead of just still seeing the aura of the plant as it's sitting in the window.
Well,
yeah.
it's like the self-reflection, everything is a wonderful thing to do, but what's the point of it if you don't do anything with it?
See, exactly that.
Right. Yeah.
Exactly that.
You know, it doesn't do anybody any good if you don't do anything with it.
Right.
You or anybody else.
And that's what Emma's saying. Let's get there and then take it out. She also says in one of these, that if you're afraid of healing someone, if you're afraid of telling someone that they are whole, like, get over yourself. Do it a couple of times. Let your ego be, you know, shattered a bit, and then continue and do it, because that's who we are, and to not fear the power that we have. It's pretty cool.
Well, I find this to be this was on page 107. I was reading past where she went. And it's like, take an hour each morning for some special message, which is cool. I do that. But then it says, take an hour in the afternoon for some words of truth to the world. And then through the day, practice speaking and thinking only praiseful thoughts towards your free self and that of your neighbor.
Right.
And every time you see your neighbor outwardly is sick or poor and unhappy, remember the real self. And it's like, God.
She didn't have a full-time job.
That's a lie.
That's right.
But I mean, I find myself, because I drive a lot, so I may drive for 2 hours, listen to audiobooks, or just be in silence, and then I get to where I'm going, and I only have to spend 2 hours with people, and then I'm on the road again for 2 hours. So it's like, instead of the berating thoughts I used to have, they've become more positive and whatever during that time of silence. So it's like, I've noticed that when I do get to that place that I'm working, people are just happier, and they like come to, before they would like avoid me, and I'd have to walk up to them, explain what I'm there for and stuff, and now they just come up and just start talking to me, and customers will just start surrounding me, and it like freaks me out a little bit. But then it's like, something's changing, something's shifting. And it must be because I'm starting to do that thing with the neighbor and not realizing it.
Could be. And always remember that where two or more are gathered, the presence is always felt. Be open to the possibility of a comrade or partner in your praise and work, someone to face you with your own divine self when you may have forgotten who you are. And we are going to end, Hopkins, on that note tonight. Unless there's something else someone would like to share. Is there something else someone would like to share?
I'm complete.
So, next week is Froward?
I believe, I think I need to look.
How many chapters of Froward do we have to read?
I thought two, but then I look at this and it says Roots Part 2. And it says Mary Baker Eddy in Christian Science. And then it says Holmes, Exposure to Christian Science. And I honestly just want to talk about Troward. And so you guys can read all of that, but I'm not going to discuss it overtly. I'm going to go right to the Edinburgh lectures and the influence of Thomas Troward on science and mind.
So how many chapters do we have to read? Troward is like hard for me.
They want you to read chapter one, Edinburgh
one through eight.
What is that?
Oh my gosh.
Chapters one through eight. I know.
They're
do
short.
Your best.
What page are you on? Please.
I don't know if Troward is on YouTube, but I got through Emerson because somebody suggested going on YouTube.
And
but
unlike
Emerson, Troward just talks in circles to me.
Well,
over,
it would be
and over.
Assuming that we're all going to be using, you know, around the same edition. It's pages all everything for week nine, 123 through 128.
Okay. Thank you. She's
and
talking
we'll
on the
workbook,
Dakota.
When we come back from the break.
Do you have another workbook?
Yeah.
Because Dakota doesn't have one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I think it's at home. Oh, brilliant.
That's fine. I can.
Or did I give them back to Nancy?
I think you gave them back to me.
I did give them back to Nancy. Did she already shred them? I wonder.
Well, we could email it to her.
Yeah.
That's good.
I can email it to you.
Do you have it in the PDF?
Yes, I do.
Got it.
Do you want to give me your
great?
Technology. Thank
it's
you.
It's a wonderful thing.
It is.
Thank
it
you
works.
For reminding me.
It always
me
does.
And here are some things that this is something that B brought, the half this of that, and then. This and I'm trying to remember who I had requested to do the closing. Was that you tonight?
No, I did it last week. I don't think you did request.
Oh,
so
a closer?
I don't think
here
you
are
did.
Some other things.
Oh, lovely. Wow. Great.
Okay.
Then I'll close. Unless there's someone, would you like to close this? Just a quick benediction. Benediction? No? Breezy?
I can if you want.
I would be honored if you would like to close this out and then I'll do the offering.
And you want us to do it like a treatment or what?
Like, yeah, like a brief treatment.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that we have come here together to learn in community from each other and from Miss Kate. And we take our learning out into the world to share so we can give. And it can be passively or just sharing amongst friends and people and acquaintances you meet.
Mm-hmm.
And I thank the universe for allowing us to have this experience. And so it is.
So it is. And what I know is that all the generosity, all the gifts that go into this basket are sent with love, and the energy is just that. It's an exchange of energy, it's an exchange of love, and that love goes out into the world, serving all who come in contact with us.
And so it is.
And so it is.
So it's all breezy.
And with great gratitude, I accept this on behalf of the Center for Spiritual Living, knowing all is well, and that we are beacons of truth, and that we are healers in spirit and divine sense. And so it is.
And so it is.
So it is.